All right. Welcome, everyone, to another one of my YouTube blog, Gaudium et Spes 22 interviews. And once again, I'm joined by some people that I hold in very high regard and I've had on here before. We have, to my left on the screen, I don't know where he is on everybody else's, Dr. Michael Hanby. We have Dr. David C. Schindler, and both Dr. Hanby and David C. Schindler teach at the John Paul II Institute of Studies on Marriage and the Family in Washington, D.C., and they have a big hand also in the production of the journal Communio, International Catholic Review. And we also have this guy I had to allow into the conversation, Dr. Rodney Howsare. I'm very happy to have Rodney here. My former colleague and buddy, what Dr. Bill Portier called the Larry and Rodney Show, which has sadly ended.
It's been resurrected online.
Yeah, online. We can do it online. Yeah. And we should do it more, Howsare. We should do it more. But it's been 10 years. I've been on the Catholic Worker Farm now for 10 years. And I turned 64 2 days ago, and every one of my arthritic bones is screaming that this farm idea was a really bad idea. Really
happy
bad.
Birthday.
Yeah. Anyway, thank you. I'll be dead soon. So, 64, death is clicking at
then
my heels.
Then you can really celebrate.
hopefully. Thank God for David Hart, because that means there's hope for me.
All right. Larry will be saved.
Dare we hope that Larry will be saved. Was dürfen wir hoffen with Larry. All right, enough banter. One thing I hate are YouTube videos where people banter back and forth for 20 minutes before they get down to the point. It's going to be a very free-ranging conversation today, not one specific topic. We're going to deal with a lot of contemporary issues in the church. I've been doing a lot of these kinds of interviews lately, and I've gotten some emails saying, hey, get off the stupid modern ecclesial problems kick. But it's important. It's important. So we're going to begin tonight with a discussion of everybody's favorite topic, synodality. And what in the heck synodality means? Is synodality a good thing, a bad thing? Do we even know what in the heck Pope Francis means by it? I'm not certain that I can figure out what he means by it. But we're going to begin the conversation with Dr. Michael Hanby first. So Dr. Hanby, Michael, I'm going to put you on the spot, because Dr. Hanby, there was an issue of Communio, not this last one, but maybe two ago, that was on synodality. And I read several of the articles, and one of them was by Dr. Hanby. What was the title of the article again, Michael? I meant to have it in front of me, but I don't.
I happened to have it here because I thought I should perhaps look at it again if we were going to talk about this to remember what I think. Synodality, sociologism, and the judgment of history.
Yes, that was the title. I thought it was an excellent article. In fact, I used many of the ideas there. I lifted them for some articles I wrote for Catholic World Report. And so it was very actually helpful to me as a kind of Grundschrift for building some ideas of my own. So let's begin with you, Michael. Let's just begin with a sort of fundamental question. What is synodality? Steel man the argument here, in a sense. Is it a good thing for the Catholic Church to be synodal? We know Vatican II spoke of collegiality. Vatican II never once used the word, to my knowledge, synodality, to apply to the church. It was really simply about the relative authority of bishops vis-a-vis the papacy, and making sure that we understood that bishops had, by ordination, the right to teach, sanctify, and govern, and that those things were not granted to them by the Pope, that there's by divine right. So that became the basis for collegiality. But that's not, it seems to me, what Pope Francis and others mean by synodality. And so why don't you just get us started by talking about that a little bit?
Well, I wish I knew, and I wish it were clear. We could start from the other end of the telescope, I suppose, and judge the tree by its fruits. And that's tempting, but I won't do that, at least to begin. One of the reasons that it's unclear is because, of course, synodality is being presented and promoted throughout Catholic media, I suppose, for lack of a better way of putting it, as the implementation at last of the ecclesiology of the council, the ecclesiology of the people of God. Despite the fact that at the time of the council, synod still meant council, and still referred to councils of bishops that were called on particular occasions to deal with particular problems. And the conversion of synod into the substantive synodality had not yet taken place. All of that is new, and therefore provokes the question that you're asking, what it is and what it means. Pope Francis has said that it is a constitutive element of the church, and the International Theological Commission issued a fairly long document a year or so ago trying to give theological flesh to the idea. And I'll confess, you know, I can only stand so much synodality. So I'm not necessarily up to speed on every utterance that has been published about it. So it's quite possible that there have been substantive explications of the concept by Pope Francis or others that I have missed. But it seems to have been a concept and a process. Oftentimes the term synodal is followed immediately by process, in search of a theological rationale and content. And even in the ITC document itself, it shifts very quickly from a kind of exegetical and theological justification for this new use of the concept into a kind of sociology of religion, in which certain ecclesial structures and processes, like parish and financial councils, for example, and the various kinds of listening processes. I think it refers to it as a style. I have to go, and there's a threefold schema that I don't have immediately to hand, that begins to sort of explicate the idea in kind of sociological terms, which raises the concern, articulated well in advance of this by Benedict XVI, is that what it represents, perhaps unwittingly, is a sociological rather than a theological understanding of the church. And of course, a sociological rather than a theological understanding of the church wouldn't just be about the church. Implicit in that would be certain implications for the doctrine of God. It goes all the way up. And so what many people, myself included, find concerning about the way this synodal process appears, well, there are many things that are concerning about the way the processes have unfolded around the world, and I assume we'll talk a bit about that. But one of the things that's most deeply concerning about it, apart from the kind of empirical and political dimensions, is the kind of self-understanding that it would imply for the church, and the possibility that it might contribute to the problem diagnosed by John Paul II, contribute unwittingly to the problem diagnosed by John Paul II and Benedict XVI, namely the eclipse of the sense of God and man in the modern world. I was going to answer your question with a description that I have here in this article from Massimo Fagioli that I would think would confirm all of my fears. It would take me a minute to find it. So perhaps Dave wants to weigh in on this while I look for it.
You look for the maximum beans quote, and then we'll come down to Dr. Schindler, and then maybe back to Michael, then down to Howsare, and we'll get around the rest. So David, go ahead.
Yeah, you know, if synodality is meant to recollect the sensus fidei and you know an idea that the church is more than just its leaders, but a community, but people of God and so forth. I mean, the problem is all of these dimensions have always been part of the church from the beginning, and you know, have gotten a certain emphasis at Vatican II, post Vatican II. You know, there's a profound affirmation of this in the notion of communio, which has been central to ecclesiology in the, you know, Vatican II, post Vatican II era. That articulation, of course, has very intentionally sought to preserve the traditional notions, that it's not a replacement for traditional notions, but very much a development of implicit dimensions and so forth that are in the traditional notions. So in other words, you know, preserves the continuity of tradition. So the idea that you would then have to, in order to affirm the sense of the faithful or something like that, or a sense of the church's community, that you have to introduce a new concept, is already, I think, provokes a certain skepticism. Now, I do think that it would be possible to try to read it in terms of the tradition, and, you know, insofar as the term is imposed on us, I think we're obligated to try to do that as far as we can. But clearly, in making that attempt, we're fighting against a certain drift, and you know, the drift. I don't want to change the subject here or redirect the conversation.
No, go ahead, because we can always go back to Michael. That's fine. Go ahead.
Yeah, I do. But I just to mention this, I mean, it seems to me that what we're witnessing is a kind of a confirmation of a theory that I've proposed about the relationship between the church and the political community, which is that there's inevitably going to be an analogy between those. And insofar as you don't recognize that and develop a sense of political community that actually has a certain ecclesiological dimension, let me put it in a more negative sense, to the extent that you have a purely secularized sense of what a political community is, that will inevitably set the horizon for how you interpret the church. And it seems to me this is basically what we have. We're witnessing here the fruition of this point when modern liberalism as a political form so fully governs the horizon of our thinking that we are not able to make sense of the traditional notions of the church and instead in ways that we think are being, you know, we attribute to the Holy Spirit. We're recasting the whole in ways that really betray Catholicism. They betray the incarnation. They betray the fundamental mysteries of the faith.
So I'm glad you brought up communio, and then we're going to go back to Michael and then down to Rodney, because one of the things Michael does bring out in his article as well is that, you know, communio presumes first and foremost a participation in the Trinitarian life of God. This is what makes us the people of God, first and foremost. That's the theological concept of the church.
Right.
But the misuse of the people of God metaphor is a purely sociologistic category along the lines of a secular polity, as you've just sort of explains why these questionnaires, like God's doing a new thing, look at what people are saying, is just utter. It's a novelty that's never been in the church before, in my view. But anyway, Michael, did you find the
Fagioli? Although it's tempting to abandon that and go search for the quote from the International Theological Commission where communio is situated within the ecclesiology of the people of God, reversing the order of Lumen Gentium, and where it says that these various procedures and structures, etc., is where our communion is made real, which is, you know, quite an astonishing thing.
Yeah.
And wow. I'm reciting that from memory. So let me qualify that by saying, I don't want to, you know, misattribute a grave problem to the ITC.
The problem is that not only is that sociology, it's bad sociology.
Yeah. Well, that's another, I mean, when you start pulling the thread of the problems here, the whole sweater comes unwound. I mean, we know unwound. We could start talking about the defects in the social science methodology used to I mean, there are all sorts of things. But I did find the quote. And I think this actually illustrates Dave's point, which I take to be substantially the same as mine, you know, from a different angle, that this is the, you know, the sociologistic understanding of the of the church is the counterpart to a conception not only of the political order, but really of the whole of reality in essentially secular terms. As effectively evacuated from the divine presence, of the divine presence, so that your basic modes of apprehending, thinking about the world are functionally atheistic.
Right.
And then yeah. God, it's an extrinsicism from below,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
It's an immanent extrinsicism. Yeah. And then you call in the Holy Spirit from without in a kind of, as a kind of add-on to that. This might illustrate this. So this is Bajoli from a 2021 Commonweal article called Who's Synodality? He says, synodal church means ecclesial processes that are less centered on the clergy and more open to the leadership of the laity, especially women. But the big question is, who and what are the driving forces of synodality? And the answer is complex. What are the social alliances at the center of ecclesial synodality in the 21st century? What classes or class fragments are allied with the church turning to synodality? What sections of the church or specific actors are at the center of the synodal movement? What organizations and networks? Where's the theology in that?
Yeah. Yeah.
Where is there any question about the reality of God, about the nature of the church? I mean, it's all processes, functions, distributions of authority and power among different groups, different alliances being played off against each other. It seems to me an utterly immanentist, political, and functionally atheistic conception of the church. Now that's just Fajoli. I'm not, but he has essentially appointed himself as the interpreter and promoter of synodality. He's absolutely relentless about it. I mean, it's an essay a day. So if this is what synodality, and he doesn't seem to get much pushback from his friends. So if this is what synodality means, and in one sense, this is such a powerful sort of media and social phenomenon that it's going to swamp whatever it is that the church actually decides anyway. Right? Yeah. So if this is what synodality is, tell me, you know, save it for me by locating the actual theological content of it in a way that is consistent with or can be interpreted in the light of not only the way the church has traditionally understood itself, but in the light of Lumen Gentium properly understood. Right. This represents the telos of the council. So where is the 1985, you know, special synod interpreting Lumen Gentium, et cetera, et cetera?
Yeah. And once comes all of a sudden the progressive discovery of ultramontanism. I mean, if you oppose all of this stuff, you're against Pope Francis. How dare you're not a very good Catholic. You're opposing something that Pope Francis. I mean, do people like the National Catholic Reporter think we don't have memories? The chutzpah of these people to suddenly start saying, you know, after they absolutely savaged Paul VI, John Paul II, you know, Pope Benedict, routinely every month in their publications. Now, all of a sudden, it's like, oh, you have to obey the Pope. But anyway, that's my soapbox. Rodney, you have been on the margins. So what say ye, sir?
Where do you even start, right? But it's, you know, I was reading a book with some students this semester by Christopher Dawson called Religion and Culture.
Yeah.
Super interesting book. And you know, his whole thesis is that with the exception of modern liberalism, every civilization on the face of the earth is the product of a religion, which gives birth to a culture, which then gives rise to a civilization. And there's a sort of organic connection in those sorts of civilizations and cultures between sort of ordinary people on the one hand, and then the priests, prophets, and kings that sort of, you know, have special roles in those societies on the other. there's a sort of both from above and from below element to it, because religion is sort of natural to human beings, and there's just, you know, there's this, you know, natural desire to kind of make stations of the sacred in time and in space, and, you know, et cetera, et cetera. And this is why Chesterton can kind of wax you very positive about the common man and common sense over the kind of the educated elite, which are usually crazy, and we can kind of trust ordinary people. But sort of the situation we've gotten ourselves into in modernity is the ordinary people. When you consult ordinary people, you're no longer consulting people who are the members of a culture which is born out of a kind of healthy religious tradition. These people have been utterly brainwashed by the propaganda of the media, it's a pervasive, one-sided depiction of everything. So when you ask, you know, what does the average Catholic think about X, Y, or Z? You know, you sort of think you're just getting this neutral opinion. You're going to get the opinions that I can totally predict what opinions you're going to get. I get from my students on a regular basis. And it's because they've been indoctrinated by another clergy. And that's what's missing here. There's this some notion that there's sort of the big old bad hierarchical church, you know, with all of its dogmas and heavy-handed one, you know, kind of top-down thing. And now we need to hear from the people, as if we're going to hear from the people. I mean, that's the problem, it seems to me. So there's a real naivete here about the possibility of democratizing the church and therefore hearing from the common man. That's gone. I mean, we don't have that anymore.
Rodney, who are the other clergy? Could you sort of describe that? That's a really intriguing proposal.
National public radio, late night comedy, you know,
it's influencers.
It's, yeah, no, that's right.
It's Twitter.
Oprah Winfrey.
But no, I mean, think about how influential, like, these guys now that are like the Johnny Carsons of our day now. I don't even know who they are anymore, but these people are extremely ideological and extremely influential on the younger generation, because they get on there and they just systematically make fun of anybody who doesn't kowtow to the latest trends. That's it, David. I think those are, they play the role of clergy now.
Rodney, have you... I'll ask the questions here, Larry, if you don't mind.
This is great.
Rodney, have you read by chance...
I'm just going to sit back.
Have you read by chance the or any of you for that matter, the national synthesis of the synodal discussions produced by the USDCB?
Unfortunately, I began to read them, yes.
Yeah.
It's exactly what you described. I mean... so many of us could have written them in advance. I mean, granted, if you look, I mean, you know, David talked about the flaws in the sociology. If you looked at the, I don't have my synodal terminology down pat, but if you looked at the materials produced prior to the Paris listening sessions, the facilitator guides and the various questions and the study guides and so forth, then it was obvious what answers were going to be elicited. The questions were constructed to elicit a certain kind of answer, as these things tend to be. But it's remarkable the extent to which you could have written this thing. I mean,
somebody
knew in advance what the Holy Spirit was going to say.
Well, what David just pointed out is a joke, but he means it seriously too. I'm so cynical about this process. I think we always need to be aware. Not only were these questions and stuff asked and very non-science, there are well established, right, the science of sociological sort of poll taking and stuff that were not followed in any way, shape, or form. But on top of that, don't tell me that the answers to these questions have not been heavily curated by the people that are in charge of this process. In fact, I know I read an article that said that there were students that were involved in the process in Philadelphia who complained loudly when they saw the summary that came out and said, our voices are nowhere found in that dialogue. There were lots and lots of more traditional minded kids there that were saying XYZ, the church doesn't need to cave into the culture, you know, the whole thing. And their comments did not show up anywhere. So this whole process, it seems to me, is a conclusion in search of an argument. And I think that the fix is in, and it's also, and we'll go back to Rodney, because I want to hear more about the modern clergy thing too. Is this not also, maybe it's just a fault of Western media reporting, but it seems to me that the whole process, the questionnaires, the listening sessions, is all weighted in the direction of the first world. I haven't heard much coming out of Asia, out of Africa, what's going on there, Eastern Europe. I haven't heard anything. That all I've heard is the Germans, the French, the Americans, the Australians. You know, so I'm wondering and look at all the issues that are raised. Those are all first world concerns, secular concerns.
You don't think the spirit is just spontaneously moving everyone on the globe to be concerned about LGBTQ accompaniment?
No, I do not. But you know, the spirit can do a new thing. So,
you know, it would be very easy to go mockingly down this road. I've been going around muttering to myself all day, measured and moderation, measured and moderation. You know, it's probably helpful to distinguish between the theology of synodality, such as it is, and the synodal process as it is taking place. Those might or might not be the same thing. And I'm with Dave. I think we're under a kind of obligation, since this has been imposed upon us, to try and interpret the theology, if we can find it, in a way that's consonant with the tradition. Having noted that, I'm going to set that aside and talk about the process for a minute. You know, I've been through the synthesis a couple of times fairly quickly. The word accompaniment comes up over and over and over again. To the best that I can see, and it's possible that I've missed it, the word truth does not.
Right.
I don't think it's in the document. Meanwhile, the spirit that we're supposed to be discerning through this process used to be called the spirit of truth. And, you know, there are so many questions already of a theological order raised by this process that are not being asked, not being rigorously thought about at all. You know, that it's difficult to imagine that a process that is so intellectual, that seems so intellectually unserious, could be spiritually serious.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and you know, traditionally speaking, the point of discernment, you know, if you think of the discretio spiritum of the monastic tradition, and even the Ignatian tradition, traditionally speaking, the point of discernment is to disentangle the voice of God from these other voices, from the world, the flesh, the devil, to put it traditionally, or from myself. I mean, it's a very, very rigorous exercise.
Which requires prayer and penance.
Yeah, a very difficult one, to discern the voice of God and to prevent my own conflating the voice of God with some other motivation. Where is that rigor?
That's a great point. Process. I mean, you would think that question would have to be raised at a certain point. Is this the voice of the world, or in the traditional sense, or the voice of God, and how do we distinguish between the two? I mean, just to raise that question, and the thing is, I mean, that question isn't raised, and to just thinking of it now, I mean, it cuts so much against the drift of, in the whole, you know, what we also recognize is the point of it. To raise that question would completely undermine why it was begun in the first place, and that should give us pause.
Is it even an imaginable possibility that in this process of discernment we may discover that we are wrong and that the spirit is telling us something else? Yeah. And not only is that question not asked, David, I mean, if you look at the facilitator questions, you know, the questions that the, at least in the U.S. or at least in an archdiocese whose name I won't mention, the question that the facilitator is supposed to ask the discussion group, one is, where did you hear the voice of God speaking to you today? It's an invitation to conflate the voice of God with whatever
you're feeling. Yeah.
Yeah. You take two steps back and it's just really hard to believe that it's come to this.
Yeah. Indeed. I said earlier that the process seems to me to be a conclusion in search of a set of arguments, and part and parcel, it seems to me, of what that conclusion is a desire to completely, and then so let's move the conversation forward a bit as to what the ultimate aims of this are. In my opinion, it's a complete overhauling of the moral theology of the church.
Yeah.
Obviously, there are ecclesiological implications and so on, as you pointed out. But I think the primary target is the moral theology of the church on a whole range of issues, which means that one of the targets is the papacy of John Paul. Yeah. One of the targets is Veritatis Splendor and Evangelium Vitae. So, Rodney, I'm gonna turn it over to you and have you comment on that, and then I want to hear what Dave has to say about that.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's absolutely right. The issue is clearly, and now, I mean, I'll speak before Dave, but I'm going to draw on Dave's work. Is when you reverse the priority of potency and act, you create a nightmare, right? So the issue, and then of course there's a whole philosophy and theology of freedom entailed there, right? But so if I think the truth is beautiful and splendid, right, and I lay out the truth in no uncertain terms, I'm doing so because I want to place the proper barriers around finite freedom that it needs to flourish as the sort of thing it is, right? So if I think that somehow truth is a threat to freedom, then I have to sort of like say, oh, well, who's to say and who's to know? And we get all the kind of epistemic humility and all this stuff. Well, you sort of know where freedom's going to go when it has no telos, right? It's going to degenerate, right? And that's exactly, I think, where we are. There's been a tendency in the last several years of the church to talk about all these things, but exactly what Michael said, don't dare talk about truth, because that's heavy-handed, it's hair-splitting, it's pharisaical, yeah,
absolutely. Rigid.
but I'm just, this is a quick example, and then I'll be done. I was reading an article the other day in the BBC, right? I was reading it online, but it was from the BBC. And this, the headline is Millennials in Sexless Marriages.
Oh, right? I saw that.
Yeah. You're like, okay, what's this about? This is
anything about sex always draws my attention.
Yeah. So I was like, I gotta check this out, because I had a feeling what it was gonna say, and it was right up my alley, right? So what's happening, of course, is that 28 to 32, whatever millennials are, they're in that ballpark around 28 to 32, give or take, are increasingly not having sex within marriage, right? Because they're married, but they're not having sex. And then you ask the question, why? And of course, I already know the answer why, but of course the BBC is going to take a long, long time to get there, because they don't want to admit the answer why, right? but they finally
pornography.
Yeah, that's exactly right. They finally get to the point where they're saying, well, it does seem that there seems to be a disinterest in sex unless there's pornography, and you know, et cetera, right? So now here's the deal, right? The church's prescriptions around human sexuality are not there in order to kind of ruin or do away with sex, right? They're there to make sex flourish in a proper context and all these things, right? But this is proof in the pudding, right? Take all the barriers away and you don't just like lose like heaven and the afterlife and God, you lose sex, right? Yeah. Yeah. I mean, hey, give the people what they want. But the problem is, it's not even at the end of the day what they want. So it's a false mercy because you're telling people, go ahead and eat chocolate before dinner and you'll still be hungry for dinner. No, you won't, right? I mean, that's what's going on, right? It's a fear of laying down any absolutes in the interest of human flourishing, but human beings don't flourish apart from a goal.
I mean, that's a point Pope Benedict made when he said, unless Eros culminates in agape, you end up losing Eros as well.
Yeah, and I mean, everybody instinctively knows that. I mean, Larry, I think you're right. It is really interesting how the moral question, I mean, that seems to be where things, where the rubber hits the road, it's always been fascinating to me in an earlier generation, humane vitae was always the question. You think, why would this issue, you think of all the mysteries of the church, but for some reason that actually bears some reflection, if a person takes a certain position on that question, you know what they hold about all the mysteries of the church. For some reason, there's a connection there that's always fascinating me. Ostensibly, it seems to me the reason for the drive to lower the bar and kind of relax norms and so forth is to express a certain sympathy and openness to the world, so that there's a sort of apologetic dimension. And initially, at the beginning of Francis's pontificate, I mean, everybody was talking about the expectations there's going to be this extraordinary wave of conversions and people coming back to the church. Of course, none of that has panned out. Now, it's interesting. This is anecdotal, but I think it's representative. I had a friend in college, a brilliant philosopher, and he and I would argue all the time, these great debates about the existence of God and so forth. I saw him a few years later, and he was telling me he never came back to the, actually, apparently things are ambiguous now, but at one point he almost did take the step into the church, and I asked him what it was, and he said it was humane vitae. And I said, what do you mean? And he said that the position that the church takes on that question could have no other reason. I mean, the church was not winning any friends in taking that position. The only possible reason is because it's true. And that made a huge impression on him. So, that's intriguing. And of course we could all have thousands of examples of lowering the bar and therefore not attracting anyone, as opposed, it's the stricter orders that are attracting people. And so there are thousands of examples. Okay. Just one last point, if I may.
No,
then why in the world is there this move, if in fact we all recognize it actually doesn't have a strong apologetic implication? One doesn't want to, I don't want to send us off in a kind of conspiracy theory sort of thing, but you can't help but think that what drives it is not so much attracting other people as it is sort of justifying oneself as a kind of I don't mean to make any sort of judgments, but any particular individuals, but it seems so much of this is a way of relieving the pangs of conscience and justifying commitments that one can't quite get out of for whatever reason and so forth. I mean, we all have had experiences of that in our own life. We all recognize it. But I wonder if that's a deeper motivation than this trying to bring the world on board.
I think that's absolutely correct in some ways, because the idea that it's going to attract people to the church is demonstrably provably, you know, incorrect by the example of Protestant denomination. I mean, you look at the German synodal way, everything that the Germans seem to want, the Protestants in Germany already have. And the Lutherans, for example, in Germany are actually in worse shape than the Catholic Church. So it's an ecclesial idea that's been tried and failed. So clearly, I think they know that. I think to a certain extent, you're right about, you know, they're trying to work something out. I would add to that, that I think that there's a certain kind of person that cannot live within the universe of cognitive dissonance very long. Mm-hmm. And by that, I mean, but the cognitive dissonance between traditional Catholicism and the priesthood of the secular world that Rodney was talking about. And so it's just easier to sort of wave the white flag and say, yeah, you know, we're just like you guys, yeah, and to be invited to the Tea Party. And I think that's got a lot to do with it as well. Michael, what do you want to add to this?
Well, I wanted to pick up on something that both you and well, that all three of you said really are an issue that we're orbiting around. I mean, you began this phase of the discussion by talking about the erasure of Humani Vitae, Veritatis Splendor, Evangelium Vitae, etc., and characterized that as a kind of contesting on the grounds of moral theology. And I think it's interesting to ask and probe a little bit more about what that would mean, or contesting in the name of what. I wrote a piece a few years ago. I was all hot and bothered for first things called A False Paradigm, where I took a look at the meaning, and people were bandying around this idea that we were in the middle of a paradigm shift. A term that they take from Thomas Kuhn's Structure of Scientific Revolutions. And people use that language without really thinking about what they're doing or what it means. But if you look at the notion of a paradigm shift and you think of what takes place when one moves from one paradigm to the other, it's not that there are a certain set of questions in the one paradigm that the second paradigm answers, and that therefore the shift takes place because the second has defeated the first. The shift takes place because the second has managed to change the subject. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that therefore the questions that were once asked are simply no longer questions anymore. And I wonder whether, I mean, when you look at, for example, again, the national synthesis, the tension that Rodney brought up between freedom and truth, between what the church teaches and the experience of people's lives, and the idea that these are at odds with one another, is there from beginning to end, and it's explicit. And yet that situation is not confronted with moral theology. Mm-hmm. So it's not as if one moral theology is being substituted for another. It's being confronted with the language of therapy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
with a sort of therapeutic pastoralism, you know, you can argue that. I mean, I'm sure there's a richer theological meaning to accompaniment, but it degenerates into therapy speak very quickly, right? And it's a therapy, and it's a therapeutic mode that is, of course, detached from any real questions of truth. You know, what human flourishing actually is, what the human being actually is, what human love actually is, etc. It's how to reconcile me with my authentic self, or what have you. And so when I notice in this document or in other synodal discussions, the complete absence of the language of truth, the fact that the thoughts being articulated don't even seem to appeal to true and false as categories, but rather to some kind of functionality or means end, you know. You can think of different substitutes for true and false, yeah, friend, enemy, means, end, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. If what you're suggesting is right, Larry, that there is, in a certain sense, an erasure of the moral theology of John Paul II, Benedict XVI, I would suggest that it's actually just the erasure of moral theology. It's the erasure of theology.
Moral theology. Yeah.
Of theology, in which thinking about that what is true has any impact on how we understand the world and how we live in it.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
That seems to be the thing that is going into eclipse here.
Right.
But I will also say that the issues, I think you're completely right about that, by the way. The issues seem to be focused in the area of gender and sexuality, which are, of course, our first world concerns. Because notice how dogmatic they get, morally speaking, on a whole range of other issues, from environmentalism, climate change, racism, sexism, homophobia. Yeah, you know, then all of a sudden they get absolutely dogmatic in their own moralisms. It's about the sex, stupid. That's what they're after here, which is why whenever I read and they say, well, we have to deal with the complex circumstances of people's lives, what they mean is sex and irregular relationships. In other words, immoral relationships that people are in that they don't want to call it that. So I'm not disagreeing with what you said. I'm taking it a little bit in a different direction. I would ask to the question of, it seems to me that lurking behind a lot of this is a fundamental, to go back to the issue of theology. By the way, the word Christ and Jesus, those words are not mentioned very much in the documents either. You mentioned truth isn't mentioned very much. Neither
is mentioned at all.
Christ, Jesus, nowhere. So that gets to the point I want to make here, which is, I mean, how does Christ come to us? In a sense, there's a problem of mediation here, it seems to me, a fundamental misunderstanding of how it is that the Spirit is mediated to us through time and history, and what those mediating structures and institutions are, theologically speaking. Dave, do you want to talk on that a little bit? Am I all wet in that?
Oh, no. I mean, if you reflect on the matter, it's interesting that you bring that up. I at one point in conversation with friends many years ago, I was pressed to identify what was distinctive about Catholicism in comparison to other religions, because typically people just have the sense of there are infinite number of religions and everyone, that's obviously not true, but there's something, religions make very distinctive claims and they can actually be considered. So what is the distinctive claim of Christianity and Catholicism in particular? And what occurred to me is it really is the principle of mediation.
Yeah, yeah.
That is the heart of the matter. How do we come to the Father? It's through Christ. How do we come to Christ? Through Mary, through the Church. What's our relationship? It's mediated through the priest, through the sacraments. And there's something I think incredibly profound about what that reveals about the nature of love, the nature of God, the nature of grace. Why it is that it's not injected in kind of an immediate way or, individually in isolation into, directly into a person's heart, but there's that one receives, one enters into relation always through another. There's something about the meaning of love and all of that. Now, if that's the case, then your observation is really a radical one, Larry. That if the principle of mediation is being rejected here, then you could say what's really being rejected is Christianity. What makes Christianity different from everything else, and specifically Catholic Christianity. But Catholic Christianity is just Christianity. I mean, I know you, Rodney, this is your area here, but one would have to spell that out. But I mean, that's extraordinary when that is the way the Church is expressing herself to the world now, is in this rejection, this forgetfulness of what precisely makes Christianity.
Yeah, we need to go read Peggy again. It's great. The last issue of Communio on mediation, great article by Jennifer Martin on, on Peggy and the carnality of the mediation that takes
place. Larry, just say that again, because everybody needs to read Charles Peggy. I think he really is a figure that needs to be recovered and holds the response to so many of the problems that face us now.
He's so relevant now.
He is, he's overlooked. I really think he is one of the great heroes of the church.
Yeah, right. I couldn't agree more.
With Nell to that as well.
You get two thumbs up on Blondell from this quarter. Rodney, you want to say something?
I would love to. Yeah, because I think that following on what Dave just said, this is absolutely where everything is kind of coming to a head right now. It seems to me is the sea change in the church that I see is this, that John Paul II and Pope Benedict wanted to include people to the church by evangelization. Mm-hmm. It's going to sound super simple, but it's just that's just what they were trying to do, right? So through the teaching office of the church, they were trying to include people into the church through inviting them to convert to this wonderful, beautiful, true thing, right? Liberalism, it seems to me, is kind of almost the perfect antithesis to Catholicism, insofar as it suggests that the way to include people in is precisely to downplay truth.
Yeah.
Right? So this is what I mean. This is what deism is. Deism is an attempt to reduce the faith to an absolute minimum of things that are self-evident, so that everybody can be included. Right. So Larry, you were talking about the fact that, like, we know this from like the United Church of Christ. Like, how many members of the, you know, it's pathetic, right? So it's like the Germans are heading in the UCC direction, which is a direction where you're going to have no members.
Right. But
I think they know this, Larry, and I don't think they care, because I literally think that they don't want people to convert to Catholicism. They don't need people to come to the physical church, which mediates salvation to us, because they wanted to already say in advance that everybody's already saved. Mm-hmm. They're saved because we're all, you know, united in some other thing. Whatever that might be, right? But that's it, right? So it really seems to me not just like a difference of emphases.
Let me stop you a second.
Yeah, yeah.
What you're saying is that not that they think that everyone might eventually be saved through a process of purification. They're already saved.
Absolutely.
In other words, they already possess salvific grace and they don't need the church for that.
It's a world of grace, Larry.
All is grace. Can I make one other observation about all of this apropos of nothing? And it's not terribly incisive philosophically or ontologically or theologically, but it's just a general observation from everything from, you know, Fagioli and Ivory on the one hand to the ITC document on the other hand to the three hands, the national synthesis. As a body of work, as a body of literature, and as a body of thought, and a body of thought that's supposedly all about the discernment of the spirit, I've never read anything more spiritless in my life.
Yeah.
The artwork.
I mean it is just suffocatingly mediocre.
Well, you've seen
there is nothing noble or beautiful or, I mean, set that over against, set it side by side with Peggy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And let beauty tell you which one is true.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, just look at the artwork that they put out, which is a recrudescence of 1970s felt banner. The one thing that came out with the woman in the vestments and the guy in the pride shirt, the only thing missing was the rotary phone on the wall and an 8-track tape player in the background. I mean, come on.
That is ideologically ugly.
Yeah.
You know, one has to try to produce something so utterly devoid of form and beauty and depth and anything that, you know, makes Christianity mystical or beautiful or great. Yeah. I mean, I can't think of a more suffocating image, but quite apart from its, you know, deeply questionable ideological content. It's that when I said at the beginning that, that this whole thing makes me very sad and depressed, and that it's hard to believe that that the church that we've come to this, that something as beautiful and great and transcendent and deep and mystical as the church could be reduced to this utterly horizontal.
Okay, so
finality to me is the thing that actually is existentially painful about it.
I'm going to that in the light of that, and this is something that I think I get emails about this all the time. I want to put you, Michael, and Rodney on the spot here, if you don't mind. You're both converts to the faith, and I get emails all the time from people who've converted from Protestantism to Catholicism to say, I didn't leave Protestantism to rediscover it again in the Catholic Church. And there are a lot of converts who I think are really sad, like you, but sad. They're disappointed. And I hate to sound therapeutic, but they're bleeding, they're wounded. They don't know where to go, because now they're rediscovering that the Catholic Church and isn't the sort of rock that they thought it was, and so on and so on. So Rodney, you've been a Catholic now for 20 some years or whatever it is, maybe longer. I don't know. We'll start with you, if you don't mind answering that question. I mean, does it piss you off?
Viscerally, yes. I mean, I get, yeah. That, I mean, that's what you're precisely, and this is what I kind of, you know, think about converts in a sense is, and this is why I think Chesterton is so amazing. Like he's raised in a latitudinarian liberal kind of British household, and he's fed a lot of really bad food. And then he discovers Catholicism. He's like, oh my gosh, this is what I've been waiting for, you know? When you convert, at least in my experience, because Michael, you were probably in a better situation because you were at least in high church Anglicanism, but I came from, you know, sort of liberal Presbyterianism for a while and, you know, liberal Anglicanism or Episcopalianism for a while. And so coming into the church was a real, you know, I felt like it's like, oh, this is finally, you know, we found something. I have to say that reading Balthazar over the years has really helped me not to have an overly idealistic view of the pilgrim church. And I mean, he says this thing one time, the old medieval adage is the entire church can't go wrong for long on a matter of central importance. Like, yeah. That's not a glowing.
Let's not bicker about who rebuked you, eh?
And long could be a century or two, you know. Like,
you don't want to get too, I don't think, as a Protestant, you don't want to get too idealistic about what the church in time at any given moment might actually look like in its fallen members and in whatever state it's in. And I take comfort in knowing that, you know, Christ is on the throne and the church will, the gates of hell will not prevail against the church. That doesn't make me happy about our current circumstances, but it does. I think if we're going to try to think in a theological perspective, it's important to remember that, you know, the church is immaculate in the heart of Mary, but almost nowhere else.
That's a great way of putting it. Certainly not in me, I'll tell you that. Michael, same question. I mean, does it anger you?
It's a complicated question, and I could spend a long time answering it, and I could get very personal, which I'll try not to do. You know, my conversion was a little bit different, I think, than many folks, and it was delayed in part because I saw what the Catholic Church looked like. You know, I was under no illusions about the state when I came, and I didn't come like many Protestants because I was suffering a crisis of authority in my own denomination. I didn't leave Anglicanism because I hated it. I left it in spite of the fact that I still loved it, because it was beautiful. and profound, and it taught me to pray, et cetera, et cetera. But one time, one of the very first things, I hadn't even been Catholic very long when I came to work at the Institute, and one of the first things we did was the faculty went to Rome for a meeting with the well, with the Worldwide Institute. And I hadn't been Catholic very long, and David's father, who was the dean, asked me, he said, well, you know, this was my first experience of sort of Roman Catholicism you know, deferential clerical speeches, et cetera, et cetera. It was kind of an interesting world. And he asked me how I felt now that I was on this side. And I said, well, I feel like I gave up the beautiful for the good and the true. And I was joking, of course, but it did kind of sum up. I mean, I recognized in the church the fullness of the faith. And not only did I recognize that, but, you know, in my own personal academic career and journey, I made a decision to try and serve that by working and teaching at the John Paul II Institute. And to feel now like that is under such assault from within. Anger is one of the responses. It's not the only one. You know, it's very sad. It's, you know, it's not great for one's personal faith journey. I mean, you really have to hold on to the rope. And remember, this is why, you know, I go back to Augustine and remind myself of eternity, which we don't hear much about in the church these days. But you sure hear about it with him, and it's saved me more than once. Balthazar as well. Piggy is a stone sticking out of a raging river to hold on to cling to keep from being washed away. But the answer to your question, Larry, is yeah, it's hard. I don't know that it's any harder as a convert than it is as a cradled Catholic who loves the church and who has striven to be faithful to it, and who has, you know, who's not ideological or does not, you know, identify being Catholic with being a neocon Americanist Republican, all of the various sort of caricatures that are heaped upon, you know, anyone who has reservations about the current zeitgeist, just ordinary Catholics who have loved the church and tried to live faithful Catholic lives. Some, you know, and I don't want to open this can of worms, you know, some in the more traditionalist wing and in the old liturgy, you know, who now find themselves, in a difficult spot, feeling spurned, I suppose.
Yeah. Yeah, as a cradle cat, I don't feel angry. I don't feel sad. I feel impatient. In the sense that an impatience that leads to, you know, when you encounter something really stupid and the person who holds the stupidity is firmly convinced that they're right and you don't know what you're talking about. And so that leads to an annoyance. So I'm impatient and annoyed and at the sheer stupidity of it all, which leads to a kind of pity more than anger. But anyway,
I would have that response more if the stupidity weren't also accompanied, it seems to me, by a good deal of dishonesty.
Yeah.
I mean, there's just a lot of dishonesty in the way that Synodality
and abuse of power. I mean,
yeah.
There are all sorts of things that you could list there.
Yeah, go ahead, Dave. Do you want to list them?
No, I don't. I do want to say. I mean, that's just you, Michael. You mentioned being in Rome. I mean, being in Rome not so long ago, walking around these ancient churches, and you realize you can't take too seriously what's going on now. I mean, the church is a permanent reality. And to me, that always relativizes these questions. If I thought that the present state of the church was the whole thing, you couldn't respect anybody who remained Catholic, in fact. But I mean, you know, I mean, we've just mentioned people, you know, Augustine and Piggy and both. I mean, you look at these figures and you realize they are people that you can, you know, hitch your cart to, I suppose. That's a lousy metaphor, but I mean, you really, I mean, they represent something that you have no doubt is good, true, and beautiful all at once, and a kind of sublimity of the of human spirit and just and Catholic sensibility, and you compare that to, you know, what else is there, as Walker Percy once answered to the question, why did you become Catholic? You know, what else is there? They said, well, you know, Buddhism, there's this. And he said, again, what else is there? You know, I mean, you look at these figures I find consolation in these figures, but it does, you know, it does make the time that we live in, you know, painful, but painful in a way that you also, you know, in a certain sense, this is a really exciting time to be alive. I mean, I don't know if we think about that often enough, but I precisely because of the depth of the human degradation going on, that there are ways that questions are coming up, things are being set into relief that had just been taken for granted for so long, that there's a kind of a drama to existence that we can participate in, that is a, you know, that's a blessing in a way. It's a blessing.
It's not often you get a front row seat to the collapse of civilization.
There you go. Exactly.
Yeah, absolutely. We're living a fall of Rome moment. Maybe one of you will write the equivalent of the City of God.
I just wanted to say real quick, though, Larry, that actually Dave just articulated the actual people of God ecclesiology, right? It's the Communio Sanctorum.
Yeah.
Well, okay. That brings, you know, we have some time left. And I, the sort of, you know, it's 60 years since the opening of the Second Vatican Council. So I want to tie this in a little bit to the legacy of Vatican II. And of course, there's a million different opinions out there. And I've written against in Catholic World Report and the National Catholic Register against this narrative that's emerged that John Paul's papacy represented a council interrupted, only now to be taken up again by Pope Francis. But then there's also emerged this sort of radical traditionalist narrative that the council was merely a pastoral council. And since the disaster happened, it obviously failed in its stated aims. And of course, I think both narratives are false, because in my view, when you say the council was pastoral, it conjures up an image of, well, it's concerned with the nuts and bolts of the church and strategies and prudential. No, the church was the Vatican II was pastoral in the sense that it sought to renew theology. This was a theological event, the council. It was largely a council of theologians for other theologians, which is what gave it its unique discursive linguistic style that a lot of critics like to go out. It's different from, there's no anathemas or canons or whatnot. It's all this discursive. It's because it's theological. So for me, 60 years later, the legacy of this council is the ressourcement theology that it promoted, that it ensconced, and that this is a project that remains completely unfinished. In large part, though, I think Vatican II is at fault for this, for not making its hermeneutical keys more explicit, perhaps. But maybe I'm wrong about that. John Paul and Benedict, I thought, make those hermeneutical keys more explicit. So what I would like to talk about now is whether or not, number one, do you agree with that analysis? I mean, the council could be other things as well, that it represents, it goes to what you said, Dave, these are very interesting times we live in. And it's a unique moment, I think, tailor-made to the kind of explosion of absolutely profound theology that's going on right now, that is the fruit and the product of the ongoing development of the ressourcement school that is being ignored, it seems to me, in the larger Catholic academy. We're certainly being ignored in Rome. So I'd like to throw that open for conversation. Rodney, let's start with you this time.
Could I just add one little bit there, though?
Sure.
I mean, There's also a pretty powerful stream that identifies John Paul II and Benedict with Vatican II precisely as a betrayal of the church.
Exactly.
Traditionalist. You didn't mention that, but I think that's
implied.
Yeah, it's a reference point that needs to be taken into serious consideration in answering your question.
Well, absolutely. I mean, it has led to this, the most benign construction you can put on the traditionalist rejection of Vatican II is like, well, we just need to ignore it because it's pastorally irrelevant now. Mm-hmm. But it's increasingly vicious and actually, once again, stupid in its theological takedown of the council, and therefore also a repudiation of the papacies of John Paul and Benedict. So you're absolutely correct. That's the narrative that needs to be combated and combated strongly. Rodney, I want to start with you if you can comment on this.
Yeah. So I would begin maybe with a paraphrase paraphrase of a Chesterton or a borrowing of a Chesterton quote, but for a different context. Is what did he say? Christianity has not been tried and failed. It's been found difficult and not tried. And I think the approach of Communio school at the Second Vatican Council is a difficult path. Why? Right. So one way of making it easy to live in a post-Christendom situation is to bunker down inside the church and speak to other people in a language that only people in the church understand, you know, kind of what Balthazar once called medievalese, right? So you sort of just hunker down and you keep repeating, commentaries on Thomas or whatever, while sort of hurling insults at the modern world, which it no doubt deserved, I mean, in many ways, right? So that's kind of still Christendom. It's just Christendom at the expense of having to go out into the world and love the world and be the salt of the world and things like that. And then of course, the other side is let's recreate Christendom by getting rid of all the things that make us different from the world. And then we have Christendom again, because we're all one big happy family, the world and the church are the same and everything's wonderful. Both of those paths are actually kind of easy if you think about it, but it seems to be what the Delu Box and the Ratzingers and et cetera, and the Daniel
the Blondells.
Yeah, the Blondells are calling for is at once to be absolutely faithful to the tradition in the biggest sense of the word fidelity, like even more faithful than some of the little t traditionalism that you see, right? Really go back to the depths and really recover and try to be faithful. And yet at the same time, without any desire whatsoever of abandoning the world to hell in a handbasket kind of mentality. That is a very, very difficult task for all of us as individual Christians, for the church as the church. And I don't think that task has really been tried. I mean, I think John Paul II and Benedict in their papacies, they kept beating that drum, but I don't know that the church as a whole really thinks that they can do that. So you're going to have the trads who are still hunkering down. You're going to have the, you know, Massimos of the world, like, hey, everybody's fine, you know. But that would be my take, you know, just to sort of in a nutshell. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Dave, go ahead.
So one of the assumptions is that in so many of these discussions is that modernity is pro-world. You know, so you're either in favor of the world, in which case you're sympathetic with modernity, or you're defending the church, in which case you hate modernity. I mean, you're exactly right, Rodney. I mean, you always miss, you know, the Communio thing is that you hate modernity because it betrays the world.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, I mean, the problem with modernity is precisely that it doesn't enter into the world and doesn't love the world and betrays it in so many different respects. And I mean, you know, so I think that's something that really needs to be faced. And that's one of the reasons I think you can call Vatican II. I mean, it's interesting to think of it as a theological event precisely as pastoral, that the very effort to love the world in a deep way, in a non-modern way, I think in the proper reading, you know, we can argue about what modernity means. That itself has a theological content. So, I mean, yeah. It complicates the judgment about what the nature of the council is when you start thinking about it in those terms. And then one last comment. What you say, Rodney, really beautifully about the two easy ways. And, you know, not only are the two, one of the reasons that those are the two easy ways is that they're the only ways that are visible in this media driven, this kind of social media world, which again is a betrayal of the world. It's not the world. Right. That if you don't take one side or the other on that question, you simply don't, your voice is just, it's just not there. I mean, you don't exist for all intents and purposes.
Yeah.
And so this communio position is disappearing. It's not on the horizon in these discussions. It's really quite extraordinary.
Yeah. And Mike, before we go to you, I just want to piggyback on what you said, Dave, about modernity is actually anti-world. In reading Jennifer Martin's article on Peggy, and it recalled so many things in my reading of Peggy from years ago, that the interesting thing is Peggy says something very similar where he says, believe it or not, modernity does not believe in historicity or flux or life. Modernity likes to mechanize and predict and control and stop the flow of life. Whereas actually Christianity, which preserves, because it preserves carnality and life, preserves a proper sense of historicity and flux and those kinds. So it preserves a proper sense of the world as world in the way that modernity does not. Anyway, Michael, go ahead.
I've got about five thoughts swirling around in my head all at once. Let me see if I can put them in some kind of an order. I mean, first of all, I think your question, Larry, points immediately to what Dave ended on. The idea that part of what the erasure the memory of John Paul II and Benedict XVI, the sort of willed and intentional erasure by some of the people who are pushing a thoroughly progressive interpretation of the council is the erasure of the idea that there already is a magisterial interpretation of the council and has been for 30 or 40 years. And that there are people who articulate that. It's the obliteration. It's the erasure of a communio interpretation of a council. And in that sense, the emergence of a kind of traditionalism that rejects the council and acts as a foil is very useful. Right. Because there's me, Fagioli, who represents the council. And then there are all these crazy traditionalist Trumpians. Right, who reject it. Missing entirely from that interpretation is the idea that there is an alternative meaning to the council than the one that you're putting forward that is already established that can contest you point by point, not just on historicist or sociologistic grounds, but theologically on what's true, what's consistent not only with the full range of conciliar documents, but with the nature of God, creation, etc. In other words, theologically, there's again no theology here. So you're pointing to something very important, which is the fact that the meaning of the council is going to be and needs to be fought over and contested for a long time. There's a great deal at stake in not letting this simply be erased. Now, one of the ways to get at what is at stake is to take two steps back and ask, why is it that the question of the church in the modern world is such a vexed question in the first place? In other words, you know, why would the council be necessary? Surely it's not only that there was this fusty old neo-scholasticism that needed to be sort of jettisoned and brought up to date. Surely the entire point is not simply aggiornamento. Let's just embrace the modern world. If that's it, you're everything that's already been said about the obliteration of any distinction between Catholicism and any other feel-good movement would hold. presumably, and answering that question would be part of what it would mean to discern the signs of the times, which the council set out to do and continually commits to us. One of the things that's so remarkable about the progressive interpretation is how utterly oblivious it is to the nature of the times we are actually now living in.
Yeah, exactly.
Right. I mean, the failure to discern the meaning of our historical moment in terms of the historical forces and the currents politically, anthropologically, et cetera, that are technologically, that are absolutely engulfing us.
Right.
Right. These people are absolutely silent about that.
Right.
And it seems to me that in its moment, theologically and metaphysically understood, that the Second Vatican Council attempted to lay the groundwork for bridging an enormous chasm that emerges in the modern period between our historical existence, you know, life in time that unfolds in novel and dramatic ways, and what is perennially and eternally true.
Right.
In of God and of the church and of nature, and the complete or the apparent jettisoning of all of that by what should we call them? That will follow Del Noce here, the neo-modernists.
Yeah.
represents not, if you look at it that way, would not represent, you know, the authentic voice of the council. It would represent one voice of the problem that the council was attempting to overcome with its sacramental conception of the church, with its Christological and anthropological center, which is which affirms both the Thomistic understanding of the human being and our historical existence. I mean, it's trying to hold together in a new synthesis things that were coming apart.
Yeah.
And now it seems to me they're coming apart again.
Yep.
And so you've got, you know, a traditionalism that has no space for history and a progressivism that has no space for eternity.
Yeah.
Yeah. To what extent, you know, the you say it's the erasure of a magisterial interpretation of the council that's already been there. Communio has been sidelined and erased and so on, and they don't seem to understand the signs of the times and the crisis that is around us. And what strikes me is that perhaps what causes this is that they bought into, this is Fukuyama on steroids, right? They bought into the notion that liberalism does represent in some sense the end point of something, that it's an inevitable, you know, to go to Del Noce, you know, it's part of this periodization of our existence from infantile stage to adult stage. Liberalism represents that adult stage. And there's an inchoate awareness that they have that the kind of Catholicism that Communio represents makes no sense outside of a classical context, which they think is impossible. They think it, you cannot go back to that. Yeah. This is where we are. It's an inevitability, and we simply have to accommodate ourselves to it, or we're going to die. Am I wrong about that? I think there's a great deal of that kind of thinking.
Well, it's liberalism is certainly the end state of something. It's the end state of politics, of properly human self-government, and perhaps the human era. We'll see.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, as we move into kind of a post-human one. What I would like to put back, I mean, let's just provisionally accept that characterization for a moment. What I would like to put back to those who operate from within that milieu of thought, or the questions that I would like to put back is, okay, then, give me your doctrine of God.
Yeah.
Give me your doctrine of creation. Let me understand how that actually makes kind of a philosophical and ontological sense, given your commitment to the authority of the sciences, your unquestioned commitment, commitment to the unquestionable authority of the sciences. Give me your philosophical anthropology, right? Of how it is, and you know, spell it out how it is that a human being has an intrinsic meaning that's more than the sum and aggregation of its parts, given the nature of of the biological sciences. Okay, if this is the view of what you're describing, then give me the Catholic faith along these various doctrinal topoi, and for that matter, the philosophy consonant with it that accompanies that. Let's see the whole picture and understand what world we're operating in here.
Yeah, I mean, but this goes back to the point you were making earlier. I mean, that, and that's precisely what will never happen. It'll never be. And the reason is the point that you made earlier about the paradigm shift. It's not a better argument. It's not a, you know. So I mean, it's interesting in Larry's description of it. This has to be embraced not because it's true, but because we have no choice.
Yeah.
This is, you know, in a way, there's this kind of historical fatalism.
Yeah.
And it simply makes the points that you're raising irrelevant,
right.
You know, on their terms. That just becomes a waste of time.
But in that case, then let's admit that we're dealing with an entirely new Catholicism.
Well, a new humanity. I mean, this is that is post-human. That stance is post-human. All
right. Yeah.
That's right. It all comes down to the fact, Michael, that we're too busy making the world a better place to be bothered by all this stuff. and we've already come to the assumption that liberalism has created a better world than, say, the Middle Ages or, you know, et cetera, et cetera. So we can't be bothered. I mean, do you guys remember? Just real quick. I mean, a few years ago, Terence Tilley gave this talk at CTSA called Impasses in Christology or whatever. Three impasses in Christology. Just very quickly. I'm telling you, this speech is literally a sacrament of what you're talking about, Michael.
You're absolutely right. I remember
either Jesus Christ is the incarnate Son of God, or he was just a great prophet, you know, wakening people up to, you know, like make it, you know, social justice and things like that. That's one of the impasses, you know, that you go through them and they're the most kind of absurd impasses. They're not impasses if you're a Catholic. One is true and one's a heresy, right? but if you're coming to it from a CTSA perspective, these are debates among contemporary theologians. And then he kind of says, you know what, there's no way to settle these, but you know what we can do? We can join hands and make the world a better place. So that's what David's saying.
The fact
that you would ask these theological questions is like, why would you do that? You know,
if I could say one thing though, in response to what you just said, Rodney, and I lost your precise formulation, something about just being indifferent to the, do you recall how you said it? Indifferent to the truth of this, just not, it can't be bothered with it.
Yeah.
It's not that they can't be bothered. It's not just that they can't be bothered. I mean, you know, as I read, and I, you know, I read a fair bit of Fagioli, so you don't have to. as I look at what form of reasoning is operating here, like what reason is in this mode of thinking, there's actually no way to think about what's true.
Yeah.
In an ontological sense. It's not just that you can't be bothered. It's that it can't be thought.
Yeah.
You can't be bothered by something you can't even see.
Yeah.
Right.
That's right. Well, and it goes to the abuse of power that you were talking about earlier, Dave. And Rodney, you bring up Terence Tilley. I mean, Tilley, the thing is, he isn't just a tiresome gas bag, which is what he is. he's also tyrannical. You talk about, I mean, when you say, can we just join hands? He doesn't want to join hands with us. He doesn't mean that. And the thing that strikes me about, to go back to Synodality,
I find that kind of a relief, frankly. But that's a whole other story. Yeah.
Yeah, I don't want to hold Terence's hand. But anyway, metaphor or not, I have this deep suspicion, right? To go back to what you were saying, Michael, about, you know, there's no truth at all, that once the synodal process achieves the goal that it wants, whatever that might be, the revision of moral theology, whatever, then the synodal process will end, right? And the authoritarianism will kick in. We've seen this. I mean, it's part of my theme that this is a kind of recrudescence of the 70s, sort of all over, unreconstructed 70s, sort of all over again. And what we saw then was a lot of talk of dialogue until the liberals were in charge, and then all dialogue stopped. And that's what sort of the Terence Tillies of the world represent to me. And it's what I see, I think, going on in Rome right now, where you see the, well, we don't want to get too much into the purging of the JP2 Institute in Rome, the purging of the Pontifical Academy for Life, deposing a bishop in Puerto Rico without any due process, the suppression of ordinations in a vocationally successful diocese in France is because the seminarians are traditionalists, not in a bad sense traditionalists, but, you know, more tradition-minded. Traditionis Custodes was a draconian, unpastoral, non-dialogical, non-reaching out to the peripheries, autocratic document from on high. And it goes back to what you said, Michael, it's because the traditionalist provided a nice foil to what he wanted to achieve. Now, I'm kind of ranting right now and taking the conversation in a different direction. But in some ways I'm not, because it seems as if power is all you have left and process towards power is all you have left when truth is gone and is off the table.
That's the irony.
Yeah. And power and process are, On one level, they might seem like opposites, but they're it's exactly the same thing, the flip side of the same coin.
It's why they're so sedulous about process,
yeah,
and their committees. They're so sedulous about it. They're so serious about it because it's a way of manipulating things.
Right.
I mean, look at Traditionis Custodes, that actually then the synodal pope now tells parishes what they can and cannot put in their parish bulletins in terms of advertising traditional Latin masses, right? You can have a traditional Latin mass, but you can't advertise it in your bulletin. How synodal is that, for crying out loud? You know, Rome micromanaging parish bulletins in North Dakota. But anyway, anybody else on that topic before we move on?
Bulletins?
no, on the topic of
finance. Yeah.
Well, you can if you want. Process, power, the erasure of truth, all that kind of, any last thoughts on that?
Michael? No, it's pervasive. I mean, someone quoted to me, someone did me the favor of not having to read the recent what's her name, Phyllis Zagano.
I don't know. Zagano. Oh, jeez.
Yeah. Is that the reporter? You know,
that was, no, was that in Commonweal or the reporter? I can't remember.
I don't remember. I mean, it's a distinction without a difference. But I read me a quote from it, and it points to exactly what you're saying. I don't know anyone who's not championing the synodal process who doesn't whatever they claim to think, or however it's dressed, it's clear that it is about, I mean, just in the way that it's presented, the way that it's thought out, that it's about the distribution of power.
Yeah.
Which means that it is about a syllogistic and, or excuse me, sociologistic and fundamentally political rather than sacramental and theological conception of the church.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And I think that's become quite clear that anyway, we've beat that horse. Well, we've gone on now for about an hour and a half, so perhaps we should wrap things up. There were a few other things I wanted to talk about, but I'm tired and my brain isn't working very well. It's
we can do it again. Right.
We don't have to reinvent every wheel tonight. But it is after 10 o'clock. And I thank you, gentlemen, for your time. I thought this was an unbelievably rich conversation. I'm always so humbled that you two, all three of you, but I'm Rodney as well. You two gentlemen and Rodney.
I'm used to that.
Well, the thing is, here's the deal, to defend myself here, you guys are guests, but when I have Rodney on the show, it's like he's still my colleague at the sales. So it's like he's the co-host of this, and you guys are the guests. But I mean this from the bottom of my heart. I have such absolute. You guys give me hope for the future of the church. You're doing such great work at the Institute. I am humbled by both your intellect and your generosity. And I am just blessed to count you as friends, and very much thank you for this conversation and for taking the time at the end of a long day, I'm sure, to do this. So thank you guys very much. You too, Howsare.
Well, the feeling is very much mutual, Larry. Thank you.
Yeah.
All right, guys. And thanks everybody for watching.
Cheers.